So just one thing, when you get my presentation and you download the SharkFest, the PowerPoint notes field has some of the, because I tend to ask a lot of questions within the PowerPoint, and I verbally answer them, but later on, if you read the PowerPoint, you won't know what it was that I was asking. So I this time, instead of putting a separate Word document, I have the answers in the notes field, okay? So just keep that in mind. So just a 10-second intro. My name is Han Sang Bae. I work for Citi, formerly known as Citigroup. And this session came about from feedback from 2011. I had asked, you know, because we do a lot of kind of a hit and run, 4 or 5 trace files at a time, and I never got a chance to deep dive into a particular trace file. And I asked the audience, you know, which do you prefer? And they said, do both. Have one session that's 3 or 4 sessions, 3 or 4 trace files, quick and dirty, and then have one where we can spend the whole time looking at one trace file. So that's how this came about. And also, in the past, you know, a lot of people ping me about where to get the trace files used in the presentation. So I just put it on box.com, and or is it box.net? No, it's box.com, right? So that link right there that you see will have the trace files that I'm presenting to you guys today. Okay? And obviously, the presentation is going to be in the SharkFest site. So again, my name is Han Sang Bae. In Citi, I have multiple roles. And the first one that I do is I own the network management space. So anytime you talk about SNMP traps, alerts, et cetera, for all of Citi, I own that space at Citi. I also own capacity management. So this is where we chart utilization on the circuits, links, uplinks, MPLS links, et cetera. And then finally, the last two, I have the WAN acceleration. I own that space. And also the troubleshooting, or what we call performance engineering. Okay, so obviously that's the most appropriate for SharkFest and why I'm here. Okay, this is going to be a very interactive session. It's one trace file. We're going to go into it knee deep. So if you have any questions, by all means, raise your hand, and then we can I can try to answer any questions you might have. Okay, all right. So the first thing. So I see a lot of repeat faces here. Just out of curiosity, first SharkFest. All right, so about 50, maybe, all right, a little more than I thought. So one of the things that I always, you know, for those of you that have attended my previous sessions, one thing that I always preach is learn to recognize patterns, right? Because a lot of packet trace analysis is about recognizing something that's different. And the more you do it, the better you get at it. And this is true across the field. I mean, if you talk to, I'm a network engineering guy, my background is network engineering, and when you do show commands, you know, you see 50 lines fly by, but you can always zero in on that counter that you're interested in, and you can do it very, very fast, right? And people who overlook your shoulder are like, what are you looking at? And you say, well, I'm looking at it right here, and you just zip through it. When you play solitaire, right, the first time you're kind of stumbling around, after a while, you can whip those cards around like crazy, or Bejewel now, I guess, is the new solitaire. So your brain gets trained very, very quickly. So your job is to open up trace files, take packet captures, baseline what the network looks like. So when there's a problem, you'll know what's different about it. Okay? And I've said this every year. If you packet capture for the first time when the problem's occurring, you won't really know what's normal, what's not normal. Okay? So you have to have a baseline. So get your and also develop a system. So when I, in my team, when we look at a trace file, we almost do it the same way each and every time. It's almost boring how we follow kind of a mental checklist, right? And some of the favorites that I have listed here, I always use relative sequence number because random 32-bit numbers are very annoying to me. So relative sequence numbers. I always add a delta column. So I know in the time field you can change it between time of day, time since epoch, but I add the delta column, and I'll show you why, because it's all about doing analysis quickly and making sure that the tool gets out of your way when you're thinking. Because when you're slicing and dicing packets and you're in that zone, you don't want to have to wait and reconfigure things. So you want to be able to get in that comfort zone and have everything lined up just the way you like it. And it's funny because when we do analysis with the team, almost somebody will always say, well, can you move this column over here? Because I'm used to seeing it on this side. And so it's all about getting in good habits, okay? I also use TCP analysis flags. First thing I do, I type that in and I scroll down fast. And we'll do that here. I also have accumulative bytes. And I use time reference markers liberally. So I think it's actually 1.8 that gave me the control T to mark the packet as time reference. So whoever developed that, thank you very much. Because before you had to go to edit, time reference. So control T much faster. And then I have multiple profiles, so I can again switch my environment in Wireshark quickly. All right, and almost always without fail, I'm going to sort by delta column. Okay, so what do I mean by that? So let's take a look at our packet capture. So this is a very, very interesting trace file. It's about, of course, you know, the network is slow, and our answer is always it's not the network. In this case, it kind of was. So I'll be the first one to admit, yeah, okay, you know, we messed up. And so we'll look at this, and again, you see how I have the length field here. I also like that. I add that length field. Cumulative bytes is my right here, and the delta column. Okay. So the first thing I do again is TCP analysis. And why do I do this? I want to know what Wireshark is telling me, and I can quickly look at it. And you should be able to immediately notice that there are a lot of what? Dupacks, right? Dupacks are bad because it signifies packet loss. But look how many there are. Is that a lot? I don't know. If you look down here, and you open up the 972 displayed out of 110,000, is that a lot? I don't know. Again, so it depends on your network, right? So just take a quick look. We see dupacks, and fast retransmission, right? As expected. Okay. And then the next thing I do is I'm going to go ahead and clear this. And look what happens. I click on the delta. Why do I click on the delta? Because I want to see what's happening in between packets, right? Almost always you're going to find that's the Achilles heel, whether you have high round trip or system delays. Delta column will spot that and bring it out. So if I scroll down, because I sorted by delta column, something interesting is happening on this screen right now, right? And this is, so when I did this, my team and I, we said, oh, something odd is going on. This is not your normal packet loss. And why do we say that? So let's kind of dissect this screen. So what do you see on this screen? Just people just kind of shout it out for me. Describe what you see on the screen. And doesn't matter if you know the answer or not, just tell me, kind of describe what's different about it, what's unique about it, so what are some of the things that pop out at you? I'm sorry? Okay. The packet numbers you're talking about, right? So packet numbers, they're kind of all over. You don't see a bunch of them clumped around 50,000, for example, 60,000, et cetera. What else? Okay, so retransmission, the source is 10 dot, so we know kind of the direction of the packet loss, right? So we know that 10 dot, the server, is transferring to 192, so we know that that's the direction of the packet loss, more than likely. What else do we notice? I'm sorry?
I've seen a lot of them on the same TCP port.
Okay, TCP port, because this actually... I've isolated to the one troublesome, but it is one TCP port. Absolutely correct. And packets are getting retransmitted, but how? Why is this different? Okay, so there's one answer right there, and then the other one was. Yeah, perfect. So those two, the last two, are the key. So the first answer was. There's push bits set, right? It's kind of hard to see. But these retransmissions have push bits set on the last four. Is that significant? We're going to find out. But it is something different, and you should file it away. The other one is they're retransmissions, not fast retransmissions, right? Is that significant? And the answer is, it is, right? So why is retransmission significant versus a fast retransmission? Yeah, so here's, in a nutshell, this is what happens, right, with Reno and the various newer TCP stack, is that when you get, and we saw this before, so when packet loss occurs, in the past, you used to have to depend on timers. They're kind of dumb timers. You start the clock when you send the packet, and you wait for an acknowledgement. And if you don't get an acknowledgement in, say, 7,500, 200 milliseconds, you just retransmit it. That takes a lot of time. 200 milliseconds is an eternity on the network, right? And you're going to hear me say that often. And so one of the ways that the feedback mechanism was improved was when you see a duplicate act saying, okay, I just sent you packets 1 through 10, and let's say 3 went missing, right? The receiver is going to say, okay, I'm good up to 1 and 2, but now I got 4, so I'm missing 3. I get packet number 5, and I'm going to still tell you, okay, packet number 5 is great, I'm still missing 3. Packet number 6 comes in. It's great that I got packet number 6, I'm still missing 3. When you hear that 3 times in a row, what's called triple duplicate, the sender retransmits immediately. Okay, there are no timeouts involved. So in a modern day network, fast retransmission isn't as painful so long as they don't occur in a tightly spaced, which is another whole session that we can get into. So fast retransmission is exactly that. You recover from errors very, very quickly. But retransmissions are not so great because you have to spend 200 milliseconds or more waiting for acknowledgement that's never going to come, and you have to retransmit. Okay? So when we sorted by, so all we did so far, right, we did nothing but sorting by delta, looking down here, and we already made a couple of mental observations. We noticed that we know the direction of the packet loss. That's important if you're network engineering and you're following the path. You know that retransmissions involve, which is interesting, and you notice that there's push bits set here. Okay? Okay, so all of that came out from just following this simple step. We didn't really do any analysis, right? All we did was we just sorted by columns, but we already know quite a bit about this packet trace file. We know it's interesting because it's retransmission, not fast retransmission. We know the push bits are set in the retransmission, so we need to make a mental note of that. So okay, any questions so far? Again, it doesn't matter how you do it, just make sure you get into a step-by-step checklist for every packet trace file. Question in the back. Okay, so that's a perfect observation, and we'll get into that when we actually do this analysis, okay? And the question was, I said it was triple duplicate, right? Three duplicates saying, I missed this packet, I missed this packet, I missed this packet, I need to retransmit. But we saw dupec number 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16. Why is that happening? And we'll get into that, okay? Any other questions? Okay, so not because I'm network engineering, but packet loss is a fact of life. It just is, right? You can't ever design a network that's line rate everywhere. We just don't have enough bandwidth to do that. But they're easy to spot. They're easy to spot because you can do TCP analysis dot flags, and you're going to see things like fast retransmission, previous segment lost, right? These are all clues as to what's going on and that there's packet loss going on, right? It's also easy to spot because where there's packet loss, there's what? Slow
performance.
Slow
data transfer.
I'm sorry?
Slow data transfer.
Slow data transfer, right? But partially it's because there's a thing called slow start, right? So slow start is a mechanism where when TCP notices packet loss, he throttles down. So it's like downshifting, right? You're cruising along at 100 miles an hour, you see packet loss, maybe a cop off to the side, and you're downshifting like crazy, right? And you're doing that because you know there's congestion, so I must not be able to send at the same rate. So what do? I back off, and there are different techniques to doing this, but the most common is I'm going to send one packet. I hear an acknowledgement back. I'm going to send 2 packets. I'm going to get an acknowledgement back, 3 packets, 4 packets. But there's a catch to that, right? And what is that catch? So in the past sessions, I've always talked about the evil odd packet, right? And there's a rule in TCP that says that when you get 2 packets, and sometimes it's 2 full MSS packets, but for now we'll just say it's 2 packets, that you can acknowledge. But if you only get 1 packet, you don't acknowledge that right away, okay? And this is piggybacking the ACK. So in other words, somebody sends me 2 packets in a row, I acknowledge that I got the 2 packets immediately. So you're going to see the acknowledgement go out instantaneously. But if someone sends me 1 packet, I'm going to sit here and say, I'm not going to acknowledge it right away if I don't have anything to send to the other guy. I'm going to just wait to see if the other packet comes. And if the other packet does come, I'll acknowledge it. But if the other packet doesn't come, I'm going to sit here and wait wait for a timer to go off, and then I acknowledge it. So every time a timer gets involved, it's wasted time, right? Because it has no intelligence. All it's doing is just counting down and doing what it's supposed to do. So let's take a look at that. It says, look at packet 12776. So we're going to see here a classic slow start behavior. So remember, the 10.dot address the server is sending to the client 192.168. And what happened a few packets above it? We see, if you scroll up, that there was packet loss. Okay? So when the packet loss happened, you're going to see the server sends one packet. Okay? And let's take a look at, just make sure, right? So 12776 is here. So what I did, the server sent is, okay, here's my sequence number. I start with 3201. The next expected sequence number is 4649.
Do you need to sort that as well?
Oh, I'm sorry. Thank you. And sure enough, there's packet loss up here, right? So what's happening here is this server is saying, okay, I'm going to send you 1448 bytes worth of data. That's all that sequence number means. Start from here, and I'm going to send you 1448 number of bytes. So my next sequence number should start with this number here that you see. Okay? And, sorry, this angle of this laptop is, there we go, much better. So now the acknowledgement says, all right, I got 4649. Okay, the last digit, 4649. That's the next expected sequence number, 4649. So we're all caught up. Then there's a delay. You can see there's a 100 millisecond delay. And then because the server got the acknowledgement back, he now sends two packets. Remember, the first one, because of slow start, he only sent one. Then he sends two. And then the next sequence number here is 7545. The acknowledgement number is 7545. Okay? So he did 1, 2, and then he sends 1, 2, 3, an acknowledgement. 1, 2, 3, 4, acknowledgement. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, acknowledgement. And then next one is going to be 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, acknowledgement. So that's the slow start, right? Now, there was something odd going on here that when my team and I looked at, we said, wait a minute, something's not right about this slow start. And what is not right about this slow start? Okay, so that's dependent, stack dependent. So in other words, it's 1, 2, 4, 8, 16 like that, or add by 1, right? So you kind of get an idea of stack and stack behavior that way. What else is odd about this? Okay, so I know for a fact that this is local data center to data center within the same data center. So I don't have a round trip that's measured in milliseconds. My round trip is measured in microseconds. And he just picked up on something that's very interesting. So I said, when you get one packet, you have to wait for the acknowledgement. So the first one, we said, oh, 100 millisecond delayed act timer, no problem. Right? Because again, the guy only sent me one packet. I'm not allowed to acknowledge that right away. I have to wait for the second packet. I'm not getting the second packet because the other guy's in slow start. Right? He has to get a proof positive acknowledgement before he sends the next two packets. So we're kind of in a deadlock. So we send the acknowledgement, and then he sends two, not just two packets, but two full-size packets. Look at the MSS, 1448. Exactly. Is that normal behavior? Absolutely not. So right away we said, of course it's not normal, because if it was normal, I wouldn't be presenting it at the Shark Fest, right? But the key point is, we caught this right away, because this is abnormal. This is not, but how do you know this is abnormal? Because you looked at other traces where the acknowledgement goes off right away. Now, to the earlier question, well, maybe there's a high round trip involved, which accounts for some of that time, but this is all local data center. So I know that there's no latency involved. Okay? So we filed it away saying, this is odd. I don't know why when he got two full-size packets, he didn't acknowledge it right away. Okay? So something very weird is going on here. All right, so we filed that away. We know about slow start. So let's go back to our presentation here. Any questions so far? So a couple rules, right? In Unix, they tend to say, and the RFC is a little bit unclear, it's a little bit vague, and So in Unix world, typically, you have to have two full MSS packets to acknowledge. So if you get two small packets, you still will not acknowledge it right away, because it's not full MSS. In Windows world, any packet counts. So if you get two 10-byte packets, Windows will immediately acknowledge. Okay? It's considered two packets, not two full MSS packets. Okay. So the next one. So we kind of went over this earlier, right? Not all retransmissions are the same. Fast retransmit, not so bad. The recovery from it is extremely fast. Okay, there are corner cases where multiple packet loss can actually hurt you as well, even with fast retransmit, even with SAC. Things we'll get into a little bit. But for the most part, fast retransmission is very efficient and it works as designed. Okay? So in today, modern day network, do we often see retransmission timeouts going off? And I have an interesting analogy there, right? Sergeant York, any Western Indian movie, and you're thinking, what the hell is he talking about? So I don't want to give away the answer, but when I explain my answer and how we got to it, you'll see what that analogy talks about. And then, of course, you know, what can you do about it? So the first question, modern day TCP stack and network, why would you encounter a normal retransmission, meaning timer-based? Because? Okay, one possible answer is that I'm losing ACKs, right? So the other guy is like, did you get it? I don't know. I didn't get an ACK back. I'll retransmit. That's one possibility. What's another one? And this actually goes to the earlier question. If there's packet loss, and I said there's triple duplicate, kind of oxymoronic name, right? It's a triple duplicate, three duplicates of the same ACK number. And you see here, this was a question from earlier, right? We see dupe ACK number 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, et cetera, Y. So this actually is a common problem now, because everybody's TCP stack has been tuned. The window size is very large, which means my send window size is very large, which means my window size is 100K. I'm allowed to send 100K worth of data without waiting for a single ACK. Okay? So it's kind of like I'm spraying the network with whatever my window size is, my send window size. And my send window size is almost always equivalent to my receive window size. So in the packet trace file, when you see the window size here, this is always the receive window size, but it turns out the send window size is exactly the same. So in this case, it's 65K. It's actually more because it's window scaling, but it's not important right now. So I'm allowed to send up to 65K of data without sending a single packet or ACK back. What that means is I can send maybe 10, 15, whatever that math turns out to be, 1,500 bytes worth of packet, and let's say I sent 50 packets that make up the 65K, right? I'm allowed to. That's my window size. So I send this out, 50 packets, but the third one gets lost, right? Just bad luck. Third packet gets lost. That means every time I get packet number 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, I can't do anything about it. That train has left the station, right? So you got 47 packets coming in, and you're going to tell me for every single packet, I lost packet 3, 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 right? So that actually turns out to be very interesting, and there's a follow-up to this troubleshooting where even the retransmissions were getting lost. And that took us down a different rabbit hole, and that's going to be a session that we can go over next year, right? So the reason why, the question back there, why do you see 1, 3, 4, 6? Because these packets are already in flight. I can't do anything about it. I can't recall them because you told me you lost packet number 3. Okay? All right. So let's take a look. So we're talking about retransmissions and fast retransmissions. And when we sorted by delta before, we noticed that here's a delta, right? It's got a push bit set. This one's interesting. So let's deep dive into this guy, 2015. Okay, so let's kind of go over what we're seeing on the screen here right now. What do we see? We see that this is a retransmission, 1440 bytes. So this didn't get to the receiver, so I'm going to have to retransmit it. So let's try and find out what happened above it, okay? Because we know, again, this packet here is a retransmission. I already sent this once, I'm going to send it again. Okay, so we know that because Wireshark saw it and said, hey, this is a retransmission, you already sent this. But the receiver, of course, didn't get it. So let's move up here and see what's happening. Now, again, when you get used to doing trace analysis, you can actually scroll up here really, really fast and something will jump out at you. Okay, but for now, let's kind of describe what we're seeing. It's always a 10 that's sending. Sometimes it's full MSS, sometimes it's not. Okay, the 192 guy is busy doing what? Acking. Does he have any data to send back? Nope. These are all what we call naked acks. Okay, length is zero. Okay, so the reason why it's 70 is because IP, TCP, overhead, etc. Okay, so let's scroll up a little bit. Okay, and see when it changes. How are we doing so far? 192 is still doing what? Acking. 10 is still sending. So believe it or not, when you're used to doing trace analysis, you actually can go faster than that and something should have just popped. Which is packet number what? 1. Why is this guy different and why did he jump out at you? This is the first time we're seeing where the client sent something to the server. It's an application level message. Why is that a big clue for us? Because FTP is a little bit different, but this happens to be NFS. So if it's NFS, you have to use block sizes, 32K, 64K, etc. So you have to say, I got the 32K, give me the next chunk, right? And then when you get it, you have to say, give me the next chunk. So you have to tell the server where you are in terms of either file name change, looking up a directory, etc. So you as a client have to give server a feedback. FTP is very different. FTP is get this file and then I don't have anything to say to you until you give me the entire file and then we just close out the connection. Question?
Does SMB or SMB2 do the same?
Yes. SMB does a lot of that and that's why SMB is terrible over wide area network because you have to constantly ask questions back and forth.
SMB2
is the same way. It's a little bit better because you can do kind of window scaling. So you can send more chunks at a time, but you still have to check, are you a file, are you a directory, do I have writes, is it open, is it locked? All these questions happen serially one at a time, okay? So this is the first time we see a packet where the client is sending something. So this is interesting to us. So what do? I'm going to mark it, time reference, control T. Or you can do it under, I think it's view. See how fast I lose my... I forgot where it was before. I think it's under edit. Yeah, edit, time reference, set time reference. So now I just use control T. Now, why is time reference important? Because it resets my big bang moment as far as packet analysis goes, right? So what I'm saying is, okay, I'm tracking cumulative bytes, and I set my time reference to here, so my cumulative byte starts adding up from time zero here. Essentially, I just made packet number 1943, packet number 1. And why did I do that? Why am I interested in cumulative bytes? Because there are only a couple of things that will drop packets in the network. Really, there's two big ones, right? What are they? What?
Congestion.
Right, there's two types of congestion, and what are they? Network-based and
host-based.
Okay. What else? From a switch. So if you're the switch, think like a switch. Okay, you can have a physical disconnect, right? And we would see that in because I own the NMS system, I would get an alert, hopefully. Okay. Errors on the link. Errors on the link is another reason. What else?
Buffers.
What kind of buffers are we talking about? Input and output buffers, and what else? When you're designing hardware and someone says, hey, make the switch, right, and I want you to make it so that it can do what? Line rate, which is packets per second. That's one bound, right? So you're bound by packets per second. The other one is?
I want to sell it cheap.
You want to sell it cheap. Yeah. Clearly you don't work for Cisco. No. So packets per second, and the other? Fabric. So there's a fabric bandwidth involved as well. But it boils down to packets per second, or how much data I can buffer. And that comes to packet size. So when you read these bake-offs and industry analyst reports about switches capability, take a look at whether they're using packets per second, or so if your packets per second limited, then large size packets are good for you because it takes a lot more large size packets to, right? But if your memory is short and you don't have as big of a memory buffer, then small packets are great because they don't hold a lot of content. So typically, you're looking at, am I dropping packets because I can't keep up with the rate of number of packets, or am I dropping because I have a buffer problem that's memory driven, meaning I can't hold on to and queue up these packets, right? Because I'm network engineering, I was curious about that to see why retransmission was occurring. So let's take a look, and let's go back to our packet where we lost the packet, which was 2015. And look at my cumulative bytes, 73,298. Is that anywhere close to boundary numbers? Boundary numbers are 2 to the 16, 2 to the 4, 2 to the 8, right? 65, 5, you know, 3, 5, 4 billion, right? Those are all numbers that mean things to folks in computer science and doing computer work, right? 73K, not really. But keep in mind, this is the whole packet. It's not just the MSS. Right? So think about this. This says the packet size is 1510. Is it 1510? Not as far as the data is concerned. It's only 1440. Right? So there's some overhead there. Okay? So what you find is there's a couple ways to find out if this happens again and again. You go look for the next retransmission, go back up to see where the client sent the message, mark it as time reference, and go back. And what we found was right around 70K mark, there was always a packet loss. Okay? So why did this retransmission occur? Let's look at the packet here. So the server is sending, and then I have a retransmission. Why is that? And why is the client not reacting as expected? Because I've killed off the last guy in a trench. Everybody's facing this way. You kill off the guy behind me, the last guy. Who's going to know that he died? That's the Sergeant York reference for those of you that saw that movie. Okay? When you're ambushing somebody, you kill off the guy in the back. Because if you kill off the guy in the front, everybody's going to see it and say, oh, we just lost a guy. Let's retransmit this guy, right? But if you lose the guy in the last packet, you don't have any more packets to send to trigger triple duplicate acts. You need packets that are following up behind you to cause the receiver to say, oh, wait a minute. I got train number 5 came in. 6 didn't come in, but 7, 8, 9 did. So I know 6 went missing. But if I got packet train number, and I always use the train analogy, I get train number 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 came in. How do I know if 9 went missing or if 9 wasn't transmitted? I don't know. So why would I send you a triple duplicate? Because I don't know if the last packet is getting lost. Okay? And this is why retransmission timeouts were coming in. Because the last packet in some type of a buffer was getting lost. Okay. So when we saw this, there's a Q&A sheet at the end of this, and I'll show you why all these problem statements started to make sense. Right. So what's as a network engineer, what are some of the options that you have on a switch to play with to try and influence this behavior? Increase the buffer size, that's one option. And by the way, if you increase it too much, you can actually make it worse because TCP gets fooled into thinking there's more bandwidth than there really is. So you're kind of breaking that congestion avoidance. Okay? But you can do that. You can increase the queue. What else? You can play with
MTU?
MTU, not so much. You can make them try. You can try to make them smaller to see if you can, you know, squeak by with less data being sent. That's one possibility. The other one is quality of service. Okay? Did you have another suggestion? No. So the reason why quality of service kicks in is in the modern day switching equipment, there's a lot of QoS that's built in behind the scenes. Okay? They might be called dynamic buffering, dynamic buffer limitation, DBL, you know, not to be vendor, so I'm being vendor neutral here. So they have other ways to let you know that, hey, I'm seeing congestion, right? Random early detect is one of the reasons why that was kicked in, right? So you feel like I'm going to hit congestion. Let me start dropping packets so that I don't get this into a massive jam down the road, okay? So what was happening in our case was that this switch was dropping packets consistently around 65K if I slammed it with high number of packets. And because the application size and the message size and the packet buffer kind of lined up, I was losing the tail end of my packet train constantly, right? So my last train went missing because the buffer would go, I can handle it, I can't handle it anymore. But it happens to be the last packet. So now my retransmission kicks in. My buffer clears, I can handle it, I can't handle it anymore. That happens to be the last packet. He goes missing again. So we saw this cyclical thing happening. So what we did was we turned off QoS to make the packet loss more random. When you make it more random, chances are you're going to lose packets, you know, in the middle, in the first quarter, the 75% mark in the train scenario, and there are packets behind it to trigger the fast retransmit. Yes, question. Yeah, you do actually. You can, yeah. So you need triple duplicates. So you need to tell, I lost a packet. Okay? Yes?
Was that port based QoS or protocol QoS?
That's port based, hardware queue. Okay? So when you, now with modern day network, the hidden danger has always been microbursts. So microbursts are things that happen very, very quickly, very, very hard to track. Right, that's a silent killer. I think the next wave of this silent killer are massive 10 gig attached system slamming equipment, networking equipment that's not quite ready to handle it. And all kinds of hell, all hell breaks loose based on QoS, based on buffers, based on TCP tuning, ill behaving TCP, right? And we'll get into all of that. Any other questions related to, yes? So the reason why, so the question was, it was a server 10 gig and the client 1 gig or vice versa, right? Why couldn't the switch keep up with the level of traffic? And the answer to that is, even the most massive and the biggest size switch has some fabric limitation somewhere, right? You don't have line rate 10 gig everywhere, because if you did, and you have a 64 gig 10 gig line card, right? The uplink has to accommodate every single one of those at line rate. Nobody makes that kind of switch. Okay? So here we're running into ASIC level buffering that came into play, and it turns out to be around 64K or so, 65K. Okay? But the server was 10 gig attached. Okay? And then, I think you have another question.
The bytes in flight show that it's only about 15K a
day. So bytes in flight. So the bytes in flight is interesting, right? Because bytes in flight means how many bytes do I have outstanding out there, right? But what concept is that? Bytes in flight. Who cares about bytes in flight? TCP. Does a silicon chip have any concept of bytes in flight?
No, but it should tell between your server and your client, right? Shouldn't it tell you what's actually between those?
It is. So the question is, if bytes in flight, right? So if I'm looking at I think this one actually didn't have that many bytes in flight. I'll check. So the question is, bytes in flight is another one that you should always check, and it tells you how much data you have outstanding on the wire. Okay? And that's a key metric to look at in terms of performance, because if I only have 16 kilobytes out on the wire at any given time, right, then I'm not being very efficient with my modern day network. Okay? Because that means at any given round trip time, I'm only sending 16K. Okay? So one of the ways we did this was we did a deep dive with the design engineer of the switch. We looked at some hidden commands, and we disabled some QoS features. Okay? And you'll notice that in this trace, I always anonymize the IP address, of course, but I've anonymized the MAC address. Because I didn't want to. I could have said this was in the middle. Like, I guess I could have done that. But I stripped out the MAC address as well. I'm not going to pick on a vendor. Yes, question.
So the QoS is on by default?
Yes, it's on by default. And be careful. When you say QoS, it means different things to different people, right? So you have, you know, for your Cisco guys, we have the, you know, the class maps and policy maps and interface. You have VLAN-based QoS. You have layer 2-based QoS. You have hardware-based QoS. You have QoS up and down, so you have to make sure that you cover each and every level, layer 2 QoS, layer 3 QoS, protocol level QoS, TCP's congestion control, etc. Okay, so be very specific when you're talking to engineers about which QoS that you're talking about. Okay? Any other questions so far? And the other way to do that too is you can export from the application message to packet loss, export that chunk to a spreadsheet, and then add up the packet size if you want. Okay. Question back there.
I want to get your input on, so we're looking at this grid, and at times grids are very big, and it could be hard to get to the point. So from the graphs that are provided, did you see, or it comes on any other ways to get to these points more quickly?
Yes. Yeah. So the question is, can you see this from a graphical standpoint? Is that the question? Yeah, you can. You can actually... So let me see if my TCP streams wasn't working, but let's see. Okay. And the reason why I couldn't get it to zoom in anymore, but let's take a look. Okay. One of the ways you can see the behavior of what I'm talking about is when you have a extreme slope. Right? And then you kind of level off. And if you zoom in here, you're going to be able to spot, because in a good transfer, you're going to see kind of a straight line. Right? As packets are flying out on the wire, you get acknowledgement back in a timely manner to keep that packets in the wire, and you have a steady growth. When you have a herky-jerky growth like this, and assuming obviously it's not processing delay, horizontal lines are no good, because that means bytes are not flying in the wire. Okay, and when you have a sudden spike leveling off, sudden spike leveling off, sudden spike leveling off, sudden spike leveling off, that's another clue that you're kind of jamming up somebody and you're taking the time to recover. Okay, because this TCP graph is nothing more than how many number of bytes I've sent out over time. Okay, so if you have an efficient transfer and it's more linear, that's always good to see. Okay, yes, question.
So I have a question. As a developer, I'm interested in feedback from people. How many people are pissed off that there are no comma in those numbers?
Thank you. I'll tell you a funny story. I'm gonna segue to a funny story. So, and it's very appropriate. So, and it was actually, I think, my first year SharkFest. It was one of the case studies. Very interesting, where Oracle downloads were not hitting random branches, and no one had any idea why. And it turned out to be MTU discovery. And so I referred back to, you know, when Usenet was excellent and not just a, you know, useless spamming. And I recalled a gentleman named Aaron in Cisco who posted something, and I said, oh, wait a minute, am I seeing this? So I went back and looked at the packet trace. Sure enough, it was. So the technical details behind it is not important. But we said, all right, I'm not sending PathMTU discovery ICMP type 3 code 4 enough. That's why these branches are being black holed. MTU discovery is not working in random branches. So we said the way to do that is there's a hidden command, IP ICMP rate limit DF 10 milliseconds. And in Cisco documentation, it'll tell you that the recommended practice is you can crank it down so that ICMP messages will go out on per interface every 10 milliseconds. And the reason why that rate limiting is there is because you can DDoS a router by having him respond to ICMP messages. Okay, so this is internal network, fairly well protected. So we decreased it to 10 milliseconds. So it was all hands on deck, 2 in the morning. And we said, all right, make the change. And I told operations, keep a count on show IP traffic, because it'll tell you in show IP traffic in Cisco router how many ICMP messages you're sending out. So I said, make a note, get the baseline, we're going to turn it on, and then in 5 minutes, we're going to check, make sure it doesn't increment like crazy. So we did that, and I said, what's the count? He said, 1 million something. I said, good. And 3 minutes later, I said, what's the count now? He goes, 10 million something. I said, oh my God. It went up by 10, 20 million in a matter of minutes. I said, we're going to DDoS our own router. We got to back out this change because something else is going on. And he goes, oh, wait a minute. I'm off by a zero. I didn't count the number of zeros right. It's the same 1 million. Why? Because there are no damn commas when you do show interface. Commas are periods for our European, you know. Right.
I'm getting some pushback because the method I proposed is not portable and doesn't work for Windows. Now, I have a solution for Windows, I think, but it sounds like I'm hearing people say we'd like this fixed.
Yeah, you know what? I'll be the first, you know, I'll be your poster boy for commas and periods or whatever, because when you're looking at large numbers, it's very hard to figure it out, right? So anyway, I had to segue because it was a funny story that reminded me of that. So the other way to do it, and I'll show you some of the other graphing methods that you can use later to spot this. And actually, it was a graphing program that found one of the root causes of this, and I'll show you that trace a little bit later. Okay? Any questions so far? The 10-dot machine is a vendor-specific OS. Yeah, so it's not a Unix, it's a vendor-specific OS. Okay, sure. All right, so let's go back to our presentation. So the reason why the Sergeant York and Western Indian movie, why is that analogy appropriate? Because the last guy in the trail was getting knocked off all the time and no one knew about it. Okay, same thing happens with retransmissions and fast retransmissions. So what recourse do you have? Well, you can play with some QoS to make the packet loss more random, right? And also, the other clue that kind of led us down this road was that when you do read and write, the performance is much better. So that's one of the things that the guys told me was, hey, when I do a read-write test, performance picks up. Not great, but it does get better. And why would that be the case? Knowing what you know now, why would that be the case? Traffic in the other direction causes what? The axe. The axe can go the other way without having to time out. So there's a better feedback because the other guy is now sending to me as well. And if he's going to send you something, he might as well give you the ACK numbers, right? Which is exactly what happens with piggybacking. And so the retransmission timeout disappeared, right? And if you look at this and you sort by the delta again, this is, I believe, a 20-second trace. A couple hundred thousand, what, 110,000 packets, right? A little hard to tell because there are no commas here, but have to get it in there. But this is about 20 seconds worth of packets in 100,000 packets. And look at the times that you waste, right? This is almost a full, and I think in a minute, 15 seconds, so it's in a different trace, but in a 1 minute trace, 15 seconds was wasted because of retransmission timeout. So when you get rid of that, that's a 25% improvement right there. Okay? Now, there's a couple other things that we looked at. We said, remember when we looked at the slow start, something wasn't right, because even though I got 2 packets, I didn't get an acknowledgement back right away, and we filed it away saying, that's not right. 2 packets were sent, you should get an acknowledgement back right away. Okay? So, Let's go to the next section. And that is, not all delays are the same. And my first bullet point here is something that I think you don't really know your stuff until you can read a textbook and say, oh, he did this wrong. This is wrong. I know this so well that I know that this book, this author, made a mistake, and I can spot it. That's when you really know your stuff. Okay? And why is that important? Because packet analysis is 80% recognition of patterns, but you have to have a fundamental foundation about how protocols work, right? Because if you looked at that slow start, just imagine that, right? So in about 2 seconds when we put that chart up, all of us went, wait a minute. Because all of us are so in tune into looking at it that we realize two packets, the ACK is delayed, that's not right. But if you don't know that RFC says that you must ACK every two packets, and you know there's no round trip, you should see an instantaneous ACK there. But because you know the protocol, you said that's not normal. If you don't know the protocol, you're going to just assume, well, I don't know why there's a delay there. Processing, I don't know, but you just kind of move on, right? So you're kind of blind to these problems if you don't have a good foundation. I'm not saying that you have to know every single thing about TCP. In fact, I had to go research part of this because they asked me, well, what happens if the retransmission gets lost? I said, you know what? Good question. I don't know. Turns out, it's actually a very tricky condition to recover from, right? Because the question back there was, I get 16 triple duplicates in a row. Which one do I trust? I can assume, right? So think about this for a second. I sent you 15 packets. Second packet gets lost. Packets number 3 to 15 will generate a triple dupe. Am I going to believe every one of those? Right? And then SAC comes into play. Right? So I didn't get into SAC yet, but SAC will tell you I have a missing hole. Right? And I have a missing hole here. I have a missing hole here. Okay? But it turns out that if you have, if your retransmission gets lost as well, just by chance, odd things happen in TCP. And it's very, very hard to recover from that. It's hard to analyze too, because it's a pain in the butt keeping track of which holes went missing again. Okay? But we did that. And we found that TCP doesn't always behave like the RFC says it's going to behave. Okay, and I'll tell you why that's significant in the next slide. So you have to become familiar with a stack so that you know when there's an odd behavior, you can pick up on it. And there's a bullet here that says use deductive reasoning. So after having gone through all these, we had a conference call with the vendor and said, your stack has a bug. I know that because I have this circumstantial evidence to show you. Okay? And what were those circumstantial evidence? Well, the first one is, the first evidence is right here. Right? I sent you two, I acknowledged two packets, and you didn't send anything for 90 milliseconds. Abnormal behavior, 100%. We know that. Okay? So that's check mark against the vendor. Okay? What else is happening here that's different? Well,
how do you show the last ACK will get lost?
I'm sorry?
How do you know the last ACK didn't get lost?
How do I know the last ACK didn't get lost? So one of the ways to prove that, because that was the first thing they asked, is how do you know it didn't get lost? Maybe it got lost, right? So what happens if an ACK gets lost? What would happen? You might see a retransmit because the ACK went missing, or the brute force way to find it is you put a sniffer here, put a sniffer there, right? And you compare. I see it here, I don't see it here. It went missing. I see it here, I see it here. You still didn't respond. I know the ACK didn't go missing, right? So in this case, we did both analysis, but in the end, we just put the sniffer right at the two edge points, and we proved that the ACK made it in. Okay? Because that was the quickest way to. But there are other ways to determine that, but it's also circumstantial. So when you're making a circumstantial case, you can't have your evidence be built on another circumstantial. And that's why we put the two sniffers there. But so let's talk about some of the other things. And one of the things that I did was, if you look at packet number, and as we were doing this, so let's see, 12780. This is one of those mystery delays that we were talking about, right? Because again, here we see a slow start, two packets, but the ACK is delayed, okay? So what's significant about this guy? Let's take a look. Window size says it's 47173, okay? So I'm the client and I said, okay, my window size is 47173. Here, it's 48621. Okay, so let's just do some quick math here. So we have 48621, and this one says it is 47173, 1448, one MSS. Okay, so what does that mean? Between this packet and this packet, my window size went down by how many? One MSS. But you got two packets, and you acknowledged two packets, right? It's a window scaling, but it's still, you know, just from 1448, window scaling doesn't come into as much of it, because, you know, you're talking just 1448, you know. So why is that significant? So look at this ACK number. So is this guy ACKing this guy or this guy? How do we know? Well, that's just plain old TCP sequence analysis, right? So this packet, which is a second 1-2, he says that next sequence number is 7545. So that's going to be my ACK number of the following packet, right, in the other direction. My next expected sequence number is 7545. My acknowledgement number is 7545. So I acknowledged it at the TCP level, but my window went down by one MSS, not two MSS. Yes?
The application only took one MSS later out.
Yes. Right. So the application, so here's what happened. So there are two different levels here. You have the TCP stack, you have the application stack. So the TCP got two packets in a row, and TCP's job is to acknowledge that. So he says, I got those two. But in that time period, application only sucked in one packet, not both. Okay? So is that, in and of itself, that may not be significant, but this was yet another mark and said, well, this is not as usual, because typically window sizes and packet numbers, for the most part, they seem to match up. Okay? If I get four packets, my window size goes up by four, etc. So this was interesting, and we saw this behavior happening again and again. All right. So what else is interesting here? Let's take a look at the other thing that we did was we did some window size analysis. One of the ways you can find out if the application is dying or if the application cannot keep up is to see a decreasing window size that doesn't snap back up. Yes. So the way it works is, as the receiver, right, because it's the receive window size that we're seeing, my job is twofold as a TCP stack. I have a warehouse where I put all the packets off to the side, right, and I say, okay, I'm good to packet number four. And then the application has to come and get whatever it needs to get. Okay? So there's two different things that are happening. In modern day, and with a lot of chimney offload, right, the application, the TCP stack is completely independent. And that's why a lot of the network analysis people use SYN, SYNACK, and ACK behavior as a true benchmark to round trip, because it has the lowest processing, because the server doesn't even get involved in that. It's the OS doesn't get involved. The TCP stack is the one that says, I got this packet, I'm going to put it here, I got this packet, I'm going to put it here, and then I adjust the window size, right, if the application takes it. Because I can't just arbitrarily make the window size, because I have to guarantee that this is going to go up to the application. Okay, because my job as TCP is to make that reliable transfer happen. Okay? Any other questions? So as we were looking at the TCP window size here, we noticed that the window size was going down, going down, going down, going down. We said, aha, application is dying. And then it would kind of snap back up, right? But it was, again, very abnormal and unusual, right? It wasn't illegal, but it was unusual. So we started to look at the window size a little bit more carefully. And one of the best features ever of Wireshark is apply as a column. Did anybody here have anything to do with that? No one here? I'll buy you lunch. So the window size here, right, applies. So all I did was I did a right click on window size and say apply as a column. So now my window sizes are all down here. Okay? So I'm going to do my delta thing again. Okay? And I sort it by the delta. I go L to bottom. So I see my packet size here is 8192. That's the first clue to what kind of stack. So when you see a window size of 8192, typically that's auto-tuning kernel, right? They start at 8K and then they kind of go up and down, ratchet up and down. Okay. What else is going on here? Nothing really jumps out right away in terms of window size. So let's do my favorite TCP analysis. So these are the dupebacks that we saw. And what's interesting about this? All 65K. Right? Every triple dupe act that we see is a different window size. Right? They're all 65K. 65535 again is a boundary number. These are numbers that you should pick up right away, right? Because they mean a lot, right? And again, when you're writing code and off by one error, the whole bit, these are boundary numbers and you have to know them, right? 4 billion whatever is another boundary number. And that was so I gotta say this one more time, sorry to segue. I'm having a conversation with a vendor, the application's not working, and I said, well, what's the counter? And he said, 4,165 something. And I said, are you sure it's 4 million and not 4 billion? And he goes, does it matter? I said, yeah, it matters, because that number you just recited is 2 to the 32, it's the exact number. And he goes, oh yeah, you're right. Oh, I'm looking at thousands, so it is exactly that number. So I said, well then, that number is not real number. Those are numbers that blow up, right? And it's telling me that stack blew up, right? The application level. So again, you have to know these boundary numbers and get to know them. So right away when we did this, we said, this can't be right. Every triple duplicate act just happens to be when I have a full window size. Every single time? Not possible. So we had another check mark against them. So when we had the conversation with the vendor, what we said was, look, here's what's happening. You get two packets and you acknowledge, but you're delayed. But you have no reason to be delayed because they're two full MSS. Why are you delaying it? Well, it only happens after packet loss, obviously, because it's triple dupes. And every one of your triple dupes involves 65K window size. It's as if you're taking a different code path. So when there's error, some other code is kicking in and handling it, and not the same code that's handling the data transfer. I can't prove it, but I have what they call what, preponderance of evidence. So we had a conversation with the developers and said, we think your error handling code is done by a different line of code and it's getting confused, and that's why it's injecting these delays. They reviewed it and they said, you're absolutely right, our error handling is incorrect. So they're writing a patch as we speak. But then, the mystery deepens. Okay? Because sometimes No one complained for days. And then all of a sudden, the performance tanks. And when I say tanks, I'm talking 600 megabits versus 30 megabits. Or 600 megabits sustained with like kilobits. It was that different. Okay? Almost order of magnitude difference. Almost. So I wasn't quite set. So I knew the root cause. I knew the retransmission timeout. I knew the buffer. We made it more random packet loss so that we don't have to pay as heavy penalty as round trip timeouts and retransmission timeouts. But this didn't sit right with me. I said something else is happening because things just don't go fix themselves, and then all of a sudden they go bad, then they go fix themselves. So one of the guys said, hey, every time I do this, it gets better. And I'm not going to tell you what this is because it'll immediately clue you off on who the vendor is. So we said, all right, we're going to recreate this the best way we can, and I'm going to turn off the switch port. I'm going to shut it down, and I'm going to bring it back up, and let's see how. And so we did that. We shut down the switch port, brought it back up, and I said, how's the performance? He goes, oh, it's good, it's good. It's just like when I do that, it's the same thing. So I said, all right. And I said, so we put a Shark appliance on it, and we said, I have a continuous capture going. Then when it tanks, give me a call within 24 hours of an approximate time frame, because I had about 24 hours worth of buffer there. It was a pretty busy Shark. And I said, I'll go back in time and see what the hell's happening. So he calls me and says, right, like 5:30 or something on a Tuesday. He goes, it just went bad. I said, okay. I went to the Shark, got the trace file, and we started looking at it. Okay? And one of the things that we do, one of my guys, his checklist, right, his pre-flight checklist is always looking at window sizes. That's what he does. Okay? So I actually have a chart. I don't have a chart here because I was using Pilot, but you can see it in Wireshark as well. So it says after switch reboot. The switch was rebooted to simulate, the SA doing something, and this was as close as we could get to it. So what happens on a switch port when you bounce it? For your network engineer types. Negotiations happen, right? Spanning tree negotiation happens. Takes about 20 seconds, right? 20 to 40 seconds, what, I forget the number now, right? You gotta listen, learn, right? Am I gonna let this packet through or not? I gotta see if you're gonna do Ether channel with me. I'm gonna see if you're gonna do what's called PHEP, port aggregation protocol. Are you a .1 QVLAN? A lot of negotiations have to happen. So the port, unless it's in port fast, or a host mode, doesn't come up right away. Okay? So when this problem happened, one of the things that Tom on my team, what he does is he looks at the windows, and we noticed that the window size went from, when it went bad, from 33K to 1 million, or 256. The window size jumped considerably. So that was kind of a clue to us. Oh, if the window size is large, that means I'm free to send more packets, right? Because I have carte blanche, right? My window size is a million. I can send a million bytes of data before I have to hear one ACK. That's what the rules are, okay? So we looked at this, and we went back in time, and we grabbed the TCP. And this is actually, it looks like it's a one-way packet, but it's not. So look at the TCP SYN behavior here. Do you see any SYNAC? Not until the very end, right? SYNAC finally happens. And what's the behavior? 3, 6, 9, 12, 15. What is this behavior? Back off behavior, right? I can't get in, I'm gonna wait, back off, double my weight, back off, double my weight, back off. Because the port, the switch port was coming up. Since the switch port was coming up, and the OS had no way of knowing. He's like trying. Oh, I got through. Okay. And this was the other side of the conversation now, the other vendor. And look at what happens when we look at the TCP option. Remember, all these up here doesn't work. Okay. So we have SAC, window scaling 16. None of these SACs made it through. Okay, Then all of a sudden down here, what options do I have there? Do I have window scaling? No. So what this equipment and this OS did was, he tries window scaling, because you know, again, why not, right? It's modern day network, 10 gigabit, lots of bandwidth. I'm gonna try with window scaling, and for a reason that the vendor could not figure out, when it couldn't connect and a certain number of backoffs had occurred, he takes, I guess, the less aggressive route or more conservative approach and opens a connection without window scaling. That triggered a bug on the other vendor because the window scaling is what killed or caused that mysterious delays to pop in. When you don't window scale, the 90 millisecond mystery delay that we saw, right? Remember those slow starts and we saw two packets and there was a 90 millisecond delay, right? One, two, where is it? This delay right here, after two packets, there's still a 90 millisecond delay. This behavior goes away if I open a connection without window scaling. And that's why the performance was good. Because when the SA did something, it opened up a new connection. It couldn't go through. It goes through without window scaling. And then after about a day or two, when NFS finally expired and there was quiescent time, it opened a new connection. Network's already in rocking. So window scaling kicks in, performance drops because a bug was introduced. Okay? So sometimes you have to be lucky to catch them. But this is my point. If you don't use deductive logic, you're gonna just kind of go off in all kinds of direction, and you may find the answer, you may not. But when we saw all these different things happening, it was kind of painting a picture of us saying, okay, the code is not right. We know that because the packet signature is different. So if the packet signature is different, something in the OS has to be involved there, right? So we knew that the vendor code was, so we kind of said, you know, we think we have a bug here. Then when, you know, never settle for, I mean, sometimes because you're busy, like if it works, move on, but be inquisitive and get to the bottom of everything. Because if I blew off the fact that it kind of works, it kind of doesn't work, I would never have figured out, or Tom actually on my team, we never would have figured out that window scaling triggered a bug. Okay? And that's why sometimes it worked, sometimes it didn't. When they did something and the TCP doesn't connect, window scaling doesn't come into play, the bug is not introduced. Okay? So that's exactly 1 hour and 15 minutes. So, and so here, so how did we figure it out? We said, well, we looked at Shark. He had the pilot view going of window sizes, so we instantly saw it jump up, right? You can also chart it from Wireshark as well with graphing, right? You set the source and tcp.window_size, you can chart that and you will see the same behavior. There was another clue, right? Read and write makes it better. Why? Because you have feedback coming, so that means that the act goes the other direction without having to wait. Window scaling is used is when it happened. QoS to turn off the packet loss, make it more random. And then we filed bugs with the vendors to get it fixed. Okay? That's it. Any questions so far? Or on the presentation?
Just got one.
Yes.
You said that window scaling was off from the trace. I saw the -1, so it looks like you didn't see the initial center.
Yeah, I'll double check. But when we pulled off the Shark from the trace, it was definitely the window scaling was not there, right? So I'll go back. And these traces, packet traces, are available on the box.com. Okay. Any other questions? Okay, so hopefully, yeah.
We were saying it was intermittent, it would be performing well and then not perform well. And then when that vendor did the trick with it,
yep.
It reset all the connections that were on and then they were all reset without those.
Yeah, so what the key thing to remember there is that when TCP cannot connect, then after the fourth retry or the sixth retry, he doesn't window scale. So the key here was you have to block that SYN. And there are certain things that happen in the network that blocks packets for a while, right? And again, I can't really go into it because I'm going to give away who the vendor is. But so that was the difference, right? So when the communication was blocked, when non-window scale TCP connection would get through, life is good. And then when the TCP timed out, because, you know, because he's done with the conversation and he fires up a new connection, he uses window scaling. And then that's when all hell broke loose.
When the vendor did
Yeah, so long as the TCP connection stayed alive with no window scaling, we were fine.
Right.
Okay.
But if they didn't do that trick, then you know they timed out. It would still continue to be poor, right?
Yeah.
Yeah,
and what I'll do is afterwards, off the mic, off the air, I'll tell you exactly what it was. Okay? Any questions so far? No? Okay, hopefully doing a deep dive like this is useful. I need some feedback. So if you think this is too long, you'd rather see short traces, hit and run type, then that's the other session that I have. Okay? So, but.